Okay, it feels like it's getting close to that time. We'll adjust microphones and we'll check our audio. See if we're streaming. Hi, everybody. Welcome. I'm wearing green. We'll talk about that in a little bit. Okay. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. That's always a good sign. We'll check Spring Lake Presbyterian Church. We'll see if we're streaming there as well. Let's see. 1 is the loneliest number that you'll ever do. Remember that? Okay. I bet I get some comments. Oh, we got some sound there. That's good. All right. Hey. Hello. Out there. This is so surrealistic. I don't know if you realize just how strange it is to be in a basement closet. Wishing you all well. But here I am in the bunker. Oh, I should not call it that. But anyway, we're still in Spring Lake. We've been back and forth all over the place, but we are here in Spring Lake today, and just so happy to be able to be with you in this way. Would love to be a little closer, a little more intimate. Many of us are getting our vaccines, and I think that is a terrific thing. There's something called vaccine shaming going on. I've seen hints of it, but I read an article in The Atlantic that talked about the fact that people are actually uncomfortable sharing the facts that they have received the vaccine. Because they feel like, well, you know, what if people think that I've taken somebody else's spot? Or, and this is interesting, maybe they don't want to reveal one of the physical qualifiers that allowed them to appropriately get in line. They didn't want people to know that they were diabetic, or they didn't want to go out and post that publicly, or some other health issue. So, folks, let's just be happy that more and more people are getting the vaccine. The CDC is now saying that if you've been vaccinated, and this is not just the CDC, but another blog that I listen to. Thank you, Holly, for turning me onto that. But who said that if you look at the protection given to you by the vaccine and a mask, 99% of that is the vaccine. So that's not to diminish the importance of wearing masks, but it is to elevate the importance of getting the vaccines. Now, this is a time that everyone has opinions. Like, that never happened before in history. That's why I preach from Scripture, by the way, folks, because today we're going to look at the Old Testament and the New Testament and talk about today, our lives today. And the fact of the matter is that the people who lived thousands of years ago, the people who lived fewer thousands of years ago, and the people who live today, you know, have one thing in common, and that is that we are human beings. And so it's interesting, the motivations, the things that drive us, the things that drove us haven't changed all that much. But the bottom line is we want to be as healthy as possible. We want to get back in worship as possible. I mean, into the churches as soon as we can. We want to be able to do these things safely. We're so close. So hang in there. I'm going to open with prayer because I think that that's a great thing to do anytime. Let's pray together. Gracious and almighty God, I thank you for my brothers and sisters in faith who are watching this, who will watch this. I thank you for those who may not believe and yet watch, if for no other reason than to just check in on Dan. I thank you for friends that I've held in my heart for so long. I thank you for family who have been connecting and reconnecting via this technology. I thank you, Lord, for all of the blessings that you've bestowed upon us. Keep us in your care and grace, and bless this time together. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, I'm hearing a little bit of rumble, so I'm going to turn off monitors. And I think that might be what's going on there. I'm going to reach over, yeah, all the technology of the studio. And I'm going to turn the, well, I think the phones are fine. So that took care of the rumble. I don't know if that was coming back through the mic. I will read your notes later. I don't read the notes live. Maybe I should. Maybe if I had scrolling, I'm sure there's a way to do that. But you know, I'm easily distracted. It's not that I have a fragile ego. Well, my heart is my heart. But I am more, look, squirrel. You know, I am easily distracted. So that is just part of my makeup. Hey, I want to go back to the 70s, don't we all? We wanna go back and celebrate and remember our teen years. I think maybe for most of us, at least physically, those were the healthiest time in our life. The things that we could do and didn't even realize that someday we'll look back at that and go, man, I used to be able to. I just can't anymore. So here we are. But this is a song that I remember. I didn't bring any coffee or water down. I'll make it. This is a song that was popular back in the, when we sat under the trees and read the way and taught each other. You know, it was not an uncool thing to do, to sit around and listen to a person playing the guitar and sing along. It was a lot of fun. So here's a throwback, way back. Oh, and we will take it up a bit. Do you remember? You can't remember because I haven't started it. Maybe now. Not the 50s. It's the same progression. The 100th song. Hallelujah, glory, hallelujah. Hallelujah, glory, hallelujah. Hallelujah, glory, hallelujah. Hallelujah, glory, hallelujah. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord. All ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence. To do a two-part, you know, did you hear me trying to do praise God, praise God, praise, that's kind of what I did because I was able to do the bass or the baritone, praise God. So anyway, I wonder if you remembered that was one of the songs that we sang a lot in our teen years. And now I am, you know, I will be 62 this year, so does that officially make me a senior citizen? I know I got my AARP card some time ago. I thought that was the threshold, but then I found out, no, you don't get any special perks. You don't get, at that threshold, whatever it was, you didn't get a free cup of coffee or anything at McDonald's. But 62, maybe I'm getting closer. It seems like they keep moving the bar. You know, when I am not a golfer, and anyone who has golfed with me or has witnessed me golfing, there was a group of guys. Yeah, this is how I talk. Thank you, my faithful studio assistant. brought me a cup of tea. That is so gracious. There was a group of guys at the Spring Lake Presbyterian Church, and the faces have changed over the years, and partly because of some of the memorial and funeral services that I have done for members of this gang. But they would meet and they would go golfing together. And some of the names are so dear to my heart, and I think so fondly of them. One of the group was a judge who played with him, and a retired judge. And he told me, he said, "Dan, we need another person. Come on, join us, Pastor." And I said, "I am not a golfer." He said, "I can teach, and anyone can play golf." And at the end of a very painful, humbling day, he pulled me to the side and he said, "You know, Pastor, not everyone is meant to play golf. So I can do some amazing things, just not consistently. If I could do them consistently, they would be called golf tricks. But they just kind of sporadically, it's more of a surprise to see what happens off the tee." So there's that. Even as a teenager, I had good friends, Barry Petrucci, who was the best man at my wedding, and Gordy Fredericks, who was at my wedding, took me out to the Lincoln Hills Country Club, and I was not a member of the Lincoln Hills Country Club. And they went golfing, and I was a caddy until we got a little ways out of sight. And they said, "Well, Dan, let's give it a shot." And I think Barry handed me out of a very nice set of clubs, probably, I don't know, 5 iron, 7 iron, somewhere along that. And I really wanted to do well, and I really wanted to show him that I was athletic and I could do this. And I swung that club, totally missed the ball. But at the arc, the highest point of that arc, the perspiration in my palms and the momentum created by the powerful swing combined to see that club just slip right out of the palm of my hand. And the three of us were standing there on the fairway watching this club helicopter. Foof, foof, foof. It just seemed to go unbelievably high. And of course, Barry, as he picked it up and, you know, some minutes later when it fell down, left the orbit, low Earth orbit, and fell, he was looking at it and trying to see if the shaft was bent. And I was never allowed to swing one of his clubs again after that. So, Barry, I'm sorry. If I owe you a club, I'll come see me. Reach out to me. We'll make it even. Oh, Diane, thank you for the tea. That helps a lot. I'm going to be preaching a message today, and I'm going to be bridging from the Old Testament to the New Testament. And that means I'm doing my songs a little early. I have a template. Sometimes it doesn't appear that way, but I do have a template. But I'm going to turn it up just a hair to say, make sure. And if it goes too loud, you guys can turn me down a little bit on your end. But sometimes we have people that say, "I can't hear you well enough." So hopefully that gain increase will help. There's one of the first album sets that I had, I remember having, was Joseph's Amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat. It was Andrew Lloyd Webber and Tim Rice. And you can get copies of that today, but you get a newer Broadway version recording, and I'm sure a very nice recording. But the album set that I had, which has long since disappeared, and I don't know if it was loaned and forgotten. Goodness knows I've borrowed enough of things of yours that I've kept. Tim Rice sang the voice of Pharaoh. So, I mean, it was a really neat collection. And by the way, Jan, thank you for those albums that you know, she saw. We have a wonderful member of the church who noticed in the background the South Pacific. And I don't know if you noticed, this is less of something to brag about, but this was my uncle's because he drove a semi, and this is his Big Mac ashtray. Yes, and there are no ashes in it from the Anderson household, but they mean a lot to me, and that was Grandma's South Pacific. But thank you, Jan, for sharing with me so many of the albums. I came back from my trip to Florida, and in my office was, you know, she had mentioned, she said, would you be interested? And I thought, yes. And I came in thinking there'd be a box, and there's a lot. So I just spent a couple minutes going through, and I'm like, oh. So fun, lots of fun to see those old stories. But the Joseph's Amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat, which is, I don't expect to be in those boxes. Tim Rice sang Pharaoh, and that, I'd love to find that. So if anyone's got that, I'd love to get a recording of that. Maybe I can even download it. I haven't tried. I know that you can download Joseph's Amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat, but it's got Donny Osmond singing. It's totally different. But there's a song, and it's the story, the opera, the rock opera, which was Andrew Lloyd Webber's and Tim Rice's. This is my understanding of the etymology, the genesis, the history. Was a project, whether it was a graduate level project or a college project, but it was one of their earliest projects together. And it's an amazing retelling of Joseph and how his father, Abraham, loved him so much and presented him with this coat of many colors, and his brothers were very jealous, and Joseph would have dreams. And the dreams were portents of the future, but when he told his brother and his father even the dreams, they were not happy because it said that Joseph would be lifted up and they would actually bow before him. Now, as we read the story in Genesis, we learn that indeed Joseph, through a series of events, ended up second only to Pharaoh in Egypt. And his brothers did indeed bow before him as he assured his family, his tribe, his clan of survival. And it was all part of God's plan. Well, one of the last songs, if not the last song in the album, is Joseph singing this. And I hope you hear it, and I hope you listen to the story, not just the words, but if your mind will allow you to listen to the story, because once again, through Andrew Lloyd Webber and Tim Rice, it gives us a vision to what is to come in God's plan. I close my eyes, drew back the curtain to see for certain what I thought I knew. Far, far away, someone was weeping, but the world was sleeping. Any dream will do. I wore my coat with golden lining, bright colors shining, wonderful and new. And in the east, the dawn was breaking, and the world was waking. Any dream will do. A crash of drums, a flash of light, my golden coat flew out of sight. The colors faded into darkness. I was left alone. May I return to the beginning? The light is dimming, and the dream is too. and I, we are still waiting, still hesitating. Any dream will do. Now, my interpretation of that song is that Joseph is dreaming at the end of his life, at the fulfillment of his part in this play that is God's plan of what is to come through what we are reading and talking about a little later this morning. So, one of the things we do at the Spring Lake Presbyterian Church every Sunday is we say hello to the children. Hello, it's good to see you. I'm going to say good morning. Those are special words. That's kind of a little, you know, precursor to what has come. But I want to tell the children, we invite them to come down to the front of the sanctuary, to come from the balcony, to come from the nursery. Parents sometimes bring them. Grandparents sometimes sat with them. We line them up in front and everyone can see them. And I start off by saying good morning, and then they shout good morning at the tops of their voices. Sometimes drives some of the old crabby people crazy. So, one, two, three, good morning! Even here in my basement, I can hear some of you shouting good morning! It's wonderful to hear you, it truly is. I'm so happy. Do you know what week this is? This is a special week, and it's, you know, it's a week in the calendar of the church, but it's also a week that many times, and I remember in elementary school, we remembered when it was St. Patrick's Day. Now, it's not today. It's coming up Wednesday, March 17th. Will be St. Patrick's Day. So this is a Sunday that is before St. Patrick's Day. Next Sunday will be just after St. Patrick's Day. But I thought I would recognize St. Patrick's Day. And one of the things that we tried to remember to do, and sometimes we didn't always remember, is to wear green. We would wear green to celebrate St. Patrick. Now, St. Patrick is the patron saint of Ireland. Now, I had a DNA study done called Family Tree DNA, FTDNA, and there are many studies out there, but as it's been refined and trying to find my biological father's lineage, and I'm still waiting because it stops at a certain point, basically at my dad, but would love to find out who his father was, and that would be a great thing, right? And so DNA can be a tool to help say, oh, I'm part of this family tree over here. There's a direct connection. And it's not on my mom's side, and it's not on my grandmother's side, on my, you know, paternal side. So, hey, you know, and then backtrace it down. And that's a way to, you know, that we find out. So I'm talking to adults as well as the children here. I realize that. But I learned that I am part Irish. It shows you a map of where you're from, Scotland, Switzerland, Ireland, even Norway, Sweden, and a little bit of Spain, a little bit of Italy. So I don't know if my hands are in the right place geography-wise, but anyway, you're following my gist. So mostly over there. I'm from over there. And it's fun to have those connections. So my Irish DNA is wearing green today. Not only in my shirt, but look at, even in my socks, I am wearing green. Look at that. Yes, it is my celebration of St. Patrick's Day. Now, Americans all often say St. Paddy's Day, and I understand in Ireland that's frowned upon, but because St. Patrick did something amazing. He brought Christianity to Ireland. And before then, they didn't know anything about Christianity, or what they knew wasn't really positive. And he showed them, maybe through his kindness, maybe through his you know, being friendly, in spite of some of the obstacles, because he lived a very challenging life. If you guys ever want to, when you're, you know, the grown-ups might look at that. But he did some wonderful things, and so the church has remembered him, and we remember him, even though a little early, Wednesday, March 17th, St. Patrick's Day. And some of you remember, if you grew up in a household like mine and it just wasn't remembered, you'd go into school and the teacher would give you a green shamrock and you'd pin that on so you didn't get pinched by the other students. Or if you grew up in a household like Diane, my wife Diane, whose grandmother was very proud not to be Irish because she was Scottish, Margaret Sinclair. Well, that was her married name. But anyway, she was definitely Scottish. And Diane, you have to, I don't remember her maiden name. It started with a T. Oh my goodness, shame on me. But anyway, she's definitely Scottish. And so Diane was not allowed as a little Scottish girl to walk to school and wear any green. And so she was always happy when the teacher gave her a little green shamrock to pin to her her Scottish colored blouse, whatever that is. So, I hope you guys can celebrate the fact that St. Patrick's Day, whether you wear green is a fun way to celebrate it. But it's also a wonderful thing to celebrate why we remember St. Patrick's Day. Because through kindness, we show other people what it's like to share God's love. And that's the best way to spread God's love, is to live a kind person and a generous person and a person who's willing to sacrifice to help other people to make their life a little better. If you have a lot of lunch, maybe you can give them half of what you've got. So both of you can be, one of you can't be full and the other one hungry. Both of you can be a little full and maybe a little hungry. What a wonderful way to show God's love. Let's take our hands, fold our hands, and bow our heads, and we're going to pray the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples to pray. And when something like this, and grown-ups, you can help. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you, kids, for coming down. It was wonderful to see you. God bless you. I always say, as they walk away back to their Sunday school or whatever it is they go, I always say, adios, arrivederci, hasta la vista, auf Wiedersehen, ciao, sayonara, aloha, papa, see you later, alligators, after a while, crocodile. On the moon, goon was Uncle Dick's retort. So, our scripture reading this morning. First of all, the lectionary passage comes from a book in the old Bible. It's called Numbers, and it's listing and some of the history of the church. And it's part of the church history where Moses is leading Israel out of Egypt. Now, interestingly enough, this connects to that song, because when Joseph went to Egypt, and that's an amazing story, he helped save Israel. And that was just, you know, part of God's plan. But then they stayed near Israel, in Egypt, and things didn't go as well, and they became slaves to the Egyptians. And there was a great deal of suffering that took place. And so there were a series of interventions that God gave warnings to the people and the leadership of Egypt to be kind and to set his people free. And that story is the story of the Exodus. And as the children of Israel are traveling through the desert, they are human beings, and they celebrate the wonderful things, but then they quickly forget them. And they point out the discomforts, or this food is horrible, it's boring, it's just, we're tired of it, even though it was given to them by God. And they started plotting against God's leadership, against Moses. And God allowed, the Bible tells us that God allowed retribution to take place, consequences to people's actions. And in one particular case, there were poisonous snakes in the region that they were traveling through. They were called fiery serpents, but biblical scholars interpret that as venomous serpents. And people were getting bit and dying. And so they realized maybe this is because of our sin, the sin of rejecting God's grace for us and wanting more. And so they went to Moses, the story tells us in Numbers, that they went to Moses and they asked for God's forgiveness. They said, petition God for us and ask him to forgive us and to save us from this horrible curse of the fiery serpents, the poisonous snakes. And Moses prayed, and God told him to make a bronze serpent and to hold it up on a pole, to lift it up. And that when an individual would be bitten by a snake and they were dying, if they would simply look in faith to that serpent that was lifted up on a pole, they would be saved. Now that's a fascinating story that has been passed down orally and then in written form for century after century after century, thousands of years. And you look for the meaning, the deeper meanings of these stories. You know, sometimes when we look at them through a lens of today, we think, oh my gosh, that was just so cruel. That was just, why would anyone want a God like that? And I think you're reading the story wrong and you're looking through the wrong lens. You're trying to look at history or a news broadcast that would be broadcast today. And you're reading something that's centuries, thousands of years, millennia old, and you're trying to judge it word for word by the same criterion. And I don't think that's how we look at that. We look at the fact that there are themes in here, and one of the themes comes up centuries later in a conversation between a Pharisee, a religious leader, named Nicodemus, and this man who had risen out of nowhere, had come from Galilee, from Nazareth, and was proclaiming good news. And he was really getting judged in a negative way. And just last Sunday, I read the passage of how he went into Jerusalem and he drove out the livestock that was being sold in the temple grounds, and he tipped over the money changers' temple. So he was obviously, you know, just causing a great deal of uproar. And Nicodemus, a Pharisee, a leader of the Jews, one of the religious leaders in the church, came to him by night. And that's the passage from John chapter 3 that I'd like to read today. Now there was a Pharisee named Nicodemus, a leader of the Jews. He came to Jesus by night and said to him, Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do apart from the presence of God. See, he had been healing people and just amazing things were happening around him. Jesus answered him, Very truly I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God without being born from above. Nicodemus said to him, How can anyone be born after having grown old? Can one enter a second time into the mother's womb and be born? Now, that's not to imply that Nicodemus thought that this was even possible. He was pressing the point, you know. You're talking figuratively, I mean, you're talking symbolically. I mean, let's carry this out. How can this be? Jesus answered, Very truly I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of water and spirit. Water and spirit. What is born of the flesh is flesh, and what is born of the spirit is spirit. Now that was the lesson, that there's a difference between this life that we are born into, that we live and that we die, that is our physical life. We're born of the flesh. But that which is born of the spirit is something more. And Jesus is beginning to reveal that deep truth to Nicodemus. And Nicodemus responds, How can these things be? Jesus answered him, are you a teacher of Israel, a religious scholar, and yet you do not understand? Very truly I tell you, we speak of what we know and testify to what we have seen, yet you, and the you there is not directed at Nicodemus. If you look at the language, it's you all, plural, you, plural, do not receive our testimony. If I have told you about earthly things and you do not believe, how can you believe if I tell you about heavenly things? No one has ascended into heaven except the one who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. And just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. Here ends the reading of God's holy word. Let us pray. Lord God, we ask and pray that you would open our hearts this day to a new and deeper understanding of the truth found in your word. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. So Nicodemus is having this dialogue with Jesus. Bible scholars tell us that he was probably an elderly man. We know about Nicodemus through John's gospel. There are three moments in John's gospel. The first is what I just lifted up to you, Nicodemus coming to Jesus at night. And there's this beautiful interlude. And then what precedes is the passage where Jesus says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whoever would believe in him might not perish but have eternal life. You know, this powerful, powerful passage of scripture. And then there's another point where Jesus has the culmination of his message and the bullheadedness of the church, the religious institution of its day. Nicodemus being a member of the courts called the Sanhedrin, and they are trying Jesus. They've taken him by night. Judas, one of his disciples, betrayed him with a kiss. He's been chained. He's been beaten. He's been spit upon and abused. And he's brought into this court at night. And Nicodemus points out bravely, because the vast majority of those who were in power were certainly not in agreement with what he was about to say. And he pointed out, be careful, because if this man is from God, what is it that we are doing? He raised the question and he was immediately just pulled down. And then a third time we hear about Nicodemus in John's gospel, and that is after Jesus has died, after he had been lifted up, just like Moses lifted up the serpent, the bronze serpent, in the desert so that people who were stung by a venomous snake might look up and look at the serpent and believe and receive life. So Jesus was lifted up in crucifixion so that the world could look to him and receive spiritual life. Life everlasting, eternal life. That is the promise of the gospel. And all the way back from the Old Testament stories, all the way through, they were looking at God's plan of salvation. What could it be? Facing the challenges that we face every day. And thinking that we're all alone. And sometimes God leaves us in solitude to be able to say, what are the solutions? Can I find them in myself? Can I find the strength within myself? And sometimes we can. We find and dig deep into ourselves and find this resolute strength that we never knew we would have had. And had we not faced that challenge, we would never have known that we had the capacity to come through that. Other times we have the opportunity to reach out to others. Maybe we've been reluctant to do so, maybe because of our pride. We're not willing to ask for help, but when others, when we are willing finally to break down that pride and ask someone else for help, that neighbor is there. And I use that term neighbor in the broadest sense of the word. That neighbor is there. Maybe no one that we ever expected that would help us. And we have a new relationship and a new friendship. You know, down through the years, Diane and I have made those relationships in those contexts. That's one of the blessings of being able to travel throughout the United States and throughout the world. To be able to have those moments with people that you connect, and some of them watch this. You know? So, hey, blessings to you guys. And I've had phone calls where I have, you know, talked to a person that I just had a sense was having a tough time. On another continent, and I've reached out to them by phone and just said, hey, I've had some thoughts. I've been thinking about you. You've been in my heart, and here's some thoughts that I've had that maybe might help, but please, even if they don't know that I was thinking about you, and I'm lifting you up in my prayers. You know, those are the types of things that can make a difference in a person's life. Sometimes as we face challenges, there's no one that can help us. And the challenges just turn out to be bigger than us. And physically, we lose. There have been people that have prayed for loved ones to live through a terminal illness, and they feel that their prayers were not answered because their loved one died. But Jesus, in his conversation with Nicodemus, says, those who are born of flesh are flesh, but those who are born of the Spirit, they live forever. That is the promise of the gospel. That spiritual healing, that spiritual component, that spiritual unity that we can have with each other as God's creation. This is not about what church or denomination that you are a member of, but as part of God's creation to respond with our heart spiritually to God. I think that's the journey that is our faith journey that we walk day to day. Let us pray. Lord God, help us as we seek a new and deeper understanding of your truth. Lord, one that is beyond our capacity to understand, that the fulfillment of which of our desire is so far above and beyond us that it's beyond our comprehension. And yet that doesn't mean it's not true and waiting for us. Gracious God, bless us, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. I'm going back, and I'm going to once again invite you to listen to the words of Any Dream Will Do, because the end of Joseph's life, as the physical life, is coming to a close. I think God, in this song, has given him a vision of Christ. What do you think? I close my eyes, drew back the curtain to see for certain what I thought I knew. Far, far away, someone was weeping, but the world was sleeping. Any dream will do. I wore my coat with golden lining, bright colors shining, wonderful and new. And in the east, the dawn was breaking, and the world was waking. Any dream will do.
A crash of drums, a flash of light. My golden coat flew out of sight. The colors faded into darkness. I was left alone. May I return to the beginning? The light is dimming, and the dream is too. The world and I, we are still waiting, still hesitating. Any dream will do.
On this St. Patrick's Day week, go out into the world in peace. Let faith, the faith that of in God's plan for you and for all of us, be the light that lights your path. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. All right, stick around. I've got some music to post. And we're going to keep doing that. We've got some little technical things, but to stick around, and I will post that in just a few moments. God bless everybody. I'm going to turn this to make sure I can see and shut this down. Bye-bye.